And the next item of business is a debate on motion 10916 in the name of Shona Robison on Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill UK legislation. I invite members wishing to speak in this debate to press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible, and I call on the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and move the motion for around 7 minutes. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's important that this Parliament gives the matter of consent to this bill careful consideration. Though much of the bill focuses on matters which are not relevant to Scotland, Part 1 has direct implications. This is because it introduces powers for UK government ministers to set targets for the 12 levelling up missions in Scotland and allows UK government ministers to report on their progress, irrespective of the fact that 6 of these relate to devolved matters. Part 6 of the bill is relevant to the interests of this Parliament, as it makes provision for introducing environmental outcome reports to replace our existing environmental assessment regimes. They are consequential links with Part 3 relating to planning data. Two miscellaneous provisions within Part 12 also apply in Scotland. These relate to the surveying profession and fees for post-marine licence services. We have engaged with the UK Government to ensure that this bill does not interfere with our devolved powers and, of course, to ensure the powers of this Parliament are respected. With regard to Part 6 and the associated provisions in Part 3 and Part 12, I am pleased to say that we have come to an agreement with the UK Government and are able to support consent for these parts. This position is a result of extensive negotiation. Under previous versions of the bill, the Secretary of State had the power to make regulations on environmental outcome reports after consulting with Scottish ministers. We have negotiated amendments to ensure that consent is required for matters within devolved legislative or executive competence. This means we will retain our existing roles and responsibilities. Scottish ministers will have discretion to consider whether there is merit in replacing our well-established and well-understood environmental assessment regimes with environmental outcome reports. Further, the UK Government has committed to reinstating the Scottish Minister's regulation-making powers for the Electricity Works Environmental Assessment Regulations, which were rendered inoperative due to Brexit and the loss of relevant enabling powers, and they have committed to doing so before the end of the current UK Parliament. And that's important because these regulations play a key role in our consenting regime for offshore renewables and related onshore infrastructure, and I'm pleased that we have been able to come to an agreement on this. Nevertheless, we remain concerned about the potential for diverging environmental assessment regimes for the consenting of offshore renewable projects. This could have a significant impact on our collective ability to meet net zero commitments. Similarly, we have secured amendments to relevant provisions of Part 3 so that the Secretary of State may only make provisions on planning data in Scotland with the consent of Scottish ministers. Whilst this is positive, I should be clear that the Scottish Government remains unconvinced that, at this time, existing arrangements for environmental assessments would benefit from a major overhaul. It's unclear whether this new regime would be consistent with existing European requirements or move us away from the current high standards for environmental assessment. This will only emerge through secondary legislation. Furthermore, there is very little detail about how any new regime would operate in practice, the outcomes that it would be seeking to achieve, and the benefits for both investors and regulators. Much more evidence and explanation would be required before we would be persuaded to make such significant changes in Scotland. When considering any future changes, we will need to carefully consider the needs of our environment and the need to reach net zero. I have no concerns regarding relevant miscellaneous provisions within Part 12 of the bill relating to the role of chartered surveyors and fees for post-marine licence services. I must be clear, however, Presiding Officer, that this Government remains firmly opposed to Part 1 of the bill relating to levelling up missions. This cuts across devolved responsibilities and therefore raises constitutional issues. I'm disappointed with the UK Government's approach to Part 1. Scottish ministers must retain the right to disagree on the principle of a bill with a view to continued and productive negotiations. This is about good governance in the face of disagreement between mature governments. Though we have a shared interest in reducing economic inequality, the route to this is not through setting targets in devolved areas. Rather, it's through redistributing economic and financial powers to Scotland in a way that allows this government to deliver the activity that will effectively target inequality. Incidentally, important themes that are picked up in the Constitution and External Affairs Committee report published earlier today, which highlights the extent to which the approach of the UK government is diminishing the role of this Parliament in scrutinising decisions taken by UK ministers in devolved areas without agreement. As written, the bill requires UK ministers to publish and report on objectives for levelling up missions, explaining when and how they will measure progress. Six of these missions, as I said, are in devolved policy areas, including transport, justice, education, skills, health and housing. These are the responsibility of the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament under the devolution settlement. Though some efforts have been made to incorporate a degree of consultation with the Scottish Government in Part 1, the provisions remain weak and vague. As it stands, there's no explicit definition or shared understanding of what would constitute meaningful consultation with Scottish ministers prior to UK Government ministers reporting on devolved matters in Westminster. The UK Government claims that this part of the bill does not require consent from this Parliament, as it covers UK-wide targets, but we strongly disagree with that. As I've set out, the levelling up missions are clearly in devolved areas and so clearly within the responsibilities of this Parliament. In our view, the UK Government is failing to respect the role of this Parliament and the allocation of responsibilities set out in the devolution settlement. Consequently, I cannot recommend consent for Part 1 of this bill. Though some progress has been made, the provisions still fail to recognise that the provisions on levelling up undermine the powers of Scottish ministers and, importantly, this Parliament. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Edward Mountain to speak on behalf of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Up to 2 minutes, Mr. Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to speak as convener of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee to highlight Part 6 of the bill on which the committee focused its scrutiny. This is an important part of the bill and relates to the environmental outcome reports. These are a new approach to the environmental assessment. The bill sets out a framework for environmental outcome reports, but much of the detail is left to subordinate legislation. In the bill, as introduced, this meant broad powers were given to make regulations in devolved areas without the consent of the Scottish ministers. This prevented the Scottish Government from recommending consent to these provisions. The committee's report encouraged both governments to agree an acceptable outcome to the matter, and the bill has now been amended so that the consent of the Scottish ministers is required before these powers are used in devolved areas. This ensures that the Scottish ministers can decide whether to agree to adopting the proposed environmental outcome report approach or to maintain the current approach. It is welcome that the governments could reach this agreement. However, the committee has also highlighted the lack of clarity about the role of the Scottish Parliament in scrutinising proposed regulations in this area. Now that the agreement has been reached between the governments, I would welcome any thoughts from the Deputy First Minister on how parliamentary scrutiny can be assured, which I'm sure we can all agree within this Parliament is hugely important. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I now call on Kenneth Gibson to speak on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Up to 3 minutes, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I speak as convener of the Finance and Public Administration Committee, which has a long-standing interest in the UK Government's Levelling Up Fund and UK Shared Prosperity Fund. Of particular interest is how effectively these funds will be spent in Scotland, the outcomes they will achieve, and their impact on Scottish Government policy and spending plans. Notwithstanding the Deputy First Minister's comments, I'll focus on amendments made to Part 1 of the Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill. This part of the bill establishes a new statutory requirement for UK Government ministers to set and review levelling up missions and report on progress. The amendments provide for UK ministers to have regard to any role of the devolved legislatures and to consult devolved authorities in relation to reviewing the levelling up missions and any changes to mission progress methodology, metrics or target dates. As a result, the committee sought confirmation that the Scottish Government will work with Parliament to agree a formal and meaningful role by which Parliament and relevant committees can be consulted on any proposals to change emissions, revise the methodology, metrics or target dates of the levelling up missions. We welcome the Deputy First Minister's confirmation that she's happy to work with the committee on a process. When there's a clearer proposal from the UK Government on how it intends to carry out the duties set out in Part 1 of the Bill. We also welcome the Deputy First Minister's commitment that Scottish Ministers will continue to operate on the basis of informing Parliament of significant policy developments, sharing relevant information where appropriate. The Scottish Government was consulted on the amendments to Part 1 which relate in part to the Parliament, but it's disappointing that the Scottish Parliament and Committee was not consulted. We would welcome a Scottish Government commitment that this will not be the case going forward and seek clarity from the Deputy First Minister in relation to the UK Government's annual report on progress in delivering the 12 missions. The Scottish Government will work with the committee to ensure that it is made available to Parliament for scrutiny. The 12 missions for the Levelling Up Fund matter since it will serve as a policy anchor across the UK Government, including in relation to funding to be spent in devolved areas. However, as a former Finance Cabinet Secretary explained in 2021, it's extremely difficult for Scottish ministers to determine how best to use capital funding. When UK ministers make decisions about capital spend, the Scottish Government is not cited on. We have written to the Secretary of State for Levelling Up asking how UK ministers intend to comply with the duty in the bill to report on how they have had regard to any Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government role. The committee looks forward to working with the Scottish Government to develop a transparent process that supports parliamentary scrutiny.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. I now call Douglas Lumsden up to 6 minutes. Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I would also like to extend my thanks to the committees and clerks who have spent time looking at this legislative consent motion back in 22 when it first came to this Parliament. And it's a pity that this devolved Scottish Government have not shown the same respect to our committee system and the processes of this Parliament in the tabling of this motion today, as we've heard from two conveners previously. Our committees are in place to provide the scrutiny, to provide reports to Parliament, some of which the devolved government will like and use, and other parts of the reports that they will disagree with, but normally in a respectful way. And it's disappointing that the committees have been treated the way, in such a poor way, over this LCM today. Mm-hmm. Presiding Officer, and we'll move on to the motion before us. I welcome the fact that civil servants of both governments have worked to ensure the measures and benefits of this bill work across the whole of the United Kingdom. Council leaders from all parties have welcomed the additional funding from the UK Parliament and have been eager to put forward projects and proposals to access it, including SNP-led councils. This is indicative of the requirement of local authorities to access much-needed funding for capital and major infrastructure projects in their areas. The Levelling Up funds have led to significant projects, such as £27 million for a new ferry for Fair Isle, £20 million for Peterhead Regeneration, £20 million for Town Centre Regeneration in Kilmarnock, £19.3 million in Fife, £18 million for Dumfries and Galloway, plus many, many more. All projects that will deliver economic growth, regeneration, business development and, most importantly, jobs. The money goes direct to our communities so they can make significant improvements to benefit their areas. Mm-hmm. Real devolution in action. Presiding Officer, I'm pleased that compromise has been found on many of the clauses within the bill in Part 3, Part 6 and Part 12. Part 1 seems to be an area of disagreement between our two governments, with one saying it goes against devolution and the other saying that consent is not necessary for setting missions. Presiding Officer, if we only had committees of this Parliament that could give us a report back with a view. It is strange that we hear from the Cabinet Secretary that she feels this is an attack on devolution, that the same week that we have a freeze of council tax imposed on local government. You know, we have seen the last week the value this government gives our local authority colleagues, ripping up the Verity House agreement before the ink is even dry. Yep. The agreement that clearly states that there should be no surprises, although according to the Cabinet Secretary, the announcement to freeze council tax was not only a surprise to local government, but also to the Shadow Cabinet. The changes proposed by UK ministers to secure legislative consent are clear that they will appropriately consult with devolved administrations and governments. The ministers will have regard to the devolved legislators and governments in preparing statements on levelling up missions. Other areas in this part of the bill ensure that Scottish ministers retain the options and controls that are required in the devolved context. Conservative colleagues will be voting to accept this motion this evening in support of our valued colleagues in local government. We want to see more investment, not less. We want to see more devolution to our communities, and we support the efforts of any government to do this. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. And I call Mark Griffin for up to 5 minutes. Mr. Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We'll be supporting the consent motion today while recognising that the bill does indeed legislate in devolved areas. Scotland and Britain needs to get building to tackle our housing crisis, and we can see why these powers are needed to align planning data and report on environmental outcomes. But the Tories' Levelling Up Bill is desperately lacking in ambition and is as thin as the white paper that came before it. Planning information, it must be used to drive improvement, but it will also expose that a decade of government cuts have hollowed out local authority planning departments. We want to see planning that delivers more genuinely affordable housing, serves communities well, and helps local businesses and town centres thrive. This bill won't do that for Scotland, but I don't think either that the National Planning Framework does that too. Now, it's welcome that the UK Government may only make planning data regulations after consulting the Scottish Ministers or if outside devolved competence. But this is a bill that has been beset by Tory backbench rebellions and government U-turns that ended up seeing the government ditch mandatory housing targets. And in ditching those targets, the Tory government let this SNP government off the hook for failing to set their own all-tenure targets, targets that we desperately need to get back to building the 25,000-plus homes a year that we need. Now, like the government here, the UK government's bill lacks ambition in its reform of compulsory purchase rules for England, hindering progress on development, delivering more houses and getting empty homes back into use. The measures in the bill will do little to address the deep inequalities that exist in Scotland and in every part of the UK. Major decisions will continue to be made in Whitehall, with communities forced to compete for small pots of money handed out by Tory ministers, with many of the poorest areas missing out entirely, something that seems to be a badge of honour for this current Tory Prime Minister. Now, if either government won't deliver on the promise to level up the country, then Labour will. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary to wind up. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank all members who have spoken in the debate today, albeit a short one. There have been some thoughtful contributions, and I will try to cover some of those. I just say to Douglas Lumsden, when he said that we should be investing more, not less, I don't see how that can be reconciled with the UK government's cut to the capital budget of nearly 7%. That doesn't deliver more, it delivers less the length and breadth of Scotland. Can I say I am very pleased that we've been able to improve some parts of this bill, and the concerns raised regarding part one do not detract from the progress made regarding parts three and six. The amendments that we've negotiated to part six and by consequence part three now recognise that the consent of Scottish ministers must be sought before the UK government makes decisions on devolved matters that will directly impact on Scotland's environment and the economy. Can I say to Edward Mountain, I will in a second, can I say to Edward Mountain, as a convener of the Net Zero Committee, very happy to take forward the issue that he raised about parliamentary scrutiny, and I'll ensure that that's progressed. Yes,
John Swinney.
Thank you, President. I'm grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. Whilst I applaud the Government's success in securing the changes that have been made in this bill, which protect devolution, would the Deputy First Minister agree with me that it would have been best for the government not to have had to face that by having a United Kingdom government that respected devolution in the first place?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say to John Swinney that, as ever, he makes a very important point, and the fact that we've had to negotiate at length in such detail over provisions that really should have respected devolution in the first place is a sign of the starting point of the UK government in this, is to try to remove and undermine devolution and to remove the powers, not just of Scottish Government, but of this Parliament. And that should be something that every one of us on a cross-party basis should be very concerned about indeed. In terms of the UK Government's commitment to a Scotland Act order reinstating specific powers of Scottish ministers rendered inoperative following Brexit, it is an important step forward in the wider context of our government's capacity to assess and regulate critical offshore renewables projects and related infrastructure, as I said earlier. So with all of the changes that have been made, I think those are significant. But we have to get back to the point of part one, and I thought Kenny Gibson made some very important points around part one of the bill.
In conclusion, please.
Yes, and his committee obviously have asked for Michael Gove as the Secretary of State for the Department of Levelling Up, Housing and Communities to provide evidence at this cross-party committee. I hope that's something the UK Government will respond to. And as I said to Edward Mountain, I look forward to working with the FPAC committee around these matters as we take them forward. Thank you.